and online. I'm so happy that we're gathering tonight on the occasion of celebrating Joe Moshenska's amazing new book, Making Darkness Light, A Life of John Milton. And so before I briefly introduce our guests, I just have a couple preliminaries. First of all, thank you for keeping your masks on during our events. We're still doing that out of an abundance of caution. And if you're online, there will be a Q&A, and you can join that conversation by putting any questions that you have in the QA function. There's a QA button at the bottom of your screen. Click on that, put your questions there, and we will keep an eye on that so that we can include you. And then last but not least, I have some people to thank: the English department, the Compliment department, and Princeton University's Humanities Council are all co-sponsors and help get word out. So, but what a great pleasure it is now to welcome Joe Moshenska, and with him also Jeff Dolven and Michael Wood, two of my favorite critics from across the street, and as Froma Zeitlin mentioned in her comment in the chat online, and I quote her, "all my faves," end quote. So Joe comes to us from Oxford, where he teaches early modern literature. His visit is a return. He did his PhD at Princeton, and Jeff and Michael were among his teachers. He's the author of three previous books. They are Feeling Pleasures, The Sense of Touch in Renaissance England, A Stain in the Blood, The Remarkable Voyage of Sir Kenelm, Digby, and Iconoclasm as Child's Play. Jeff Dolven teaches poetry and poetics, especially of the English Renaissance, in the English department at Princeton, and his books of criticism are Scenes of Instruction, Senses of Style, and the brief and whimsically unsettling Take Care. He is also a wonderful poet, and if you haven't read his collection of poetry, Speculative Music, I urge you to do that. Michael Wood, of course, is Professor Emeritus of English and Comparative at Princeton, and his range as critic, writing regularly for the New York Review of Books, the London Review of Books, many other places, is exceptional. The same is true of his many, many books, too many for me to list them all. So just a sampling of some faves of mine. The Magician's Doubts, Nabokov and the Rise of Fiction, Children of Silence on Contemporary Fiction, The Road to Delphi of the Life and Afterlife of Oracles, Literature and the Taste of Knowledge, Yeats and Violets. But we are here to talk about Milton today. And Milton is an important writer for some of the people that I'm closest to, and I have Jeff here behind me among those. And nevertheless, I had to make many attempts over the years at reading Paradise Lost before only last year one took. And then along comes Joe's book, which not only gives me permission for my own ambivalent and often difficult experience in reading Milton, but helps me revalue it, find meaning in the ambivalence, begin to know that ambivalence is itself a way of knowing as well as something to know about Milton. This is a very special kind of biography, and I'm certain that tonight's conversation will give you a flavor of that. It is one in which, in many always subtle, surprising in key shining moments, counterfactual and deeply personal ways, Joe sort of helps to reinvent what a biography can do and what it can be. The book is set to an irregularly regular beat, and it always explains to you why that is and why an attunement to these rhythms is necessary to understanding Milton, Milton the person, Milton in his time, and of course his poetry. Bonhomme writes somewhere in a formulation that I really love that rhythm is delay. If that's the case, then I arrive at Milton right on time. And for this reader, Joe's book too arrives right on time. Please help me welcome our guests.
Thank you so much. That wonderful introduction, Dorothea. Am I saying a few words first? And then thank you. And some brief thank yous. It is unbelievably exciting to be here. I've always always loved coming back to Princeton since I left. Of course, we are all now experiencing the excitement of being able to do things together once again in new ways, to travel to places we haven't been. And so I've been wandering around town on this beautiful day in a mood of delirious nostalgia. And this event feels like the best culmination of that. So thanks so much to Dorothea and Labyrinth for hosting it, to Jeff and to Michael for their participation, to all of you for attending, for everyone who's online. I'm not sure who's on the online list. I'm very pleased you're here, Froma. Thank you for that, for those kind words. I bought one of your old books upstairs today. It had your name written inside on the flyleaf. So I've added that to my library and I'll be taking back to England with me. I'm just going to start off by not saying very much. We haven't sort of got a script really at all. I'm really just excited to see what Jeff and Michael want to ask me or talk about in relation to this book. So I think all I'm going to do at the start is say a couple of words about the overall conception of, and approach, and just read a short bit of it to give you a flavour of it. And as Dorothea said, it's a book that I hope works as a biography. I hope it gives you an account of Milton's life and his writings. But that tries to approach the question of what it means to write a biography in general, and a biography of Milton in particular, in certain distinctive ways. And I was thinking about what Dorothea said about ambivalence, which is a really important starting point for me. And I suppose one thing I tried to do with this book is write a book about a famous and well-known and super established and hyper-canonical poet that tried not to take for granted that he mattered or that we should spend our time with him. That feels to me like the starting point of the kind of enterprise of understanding a really major sort of towering figure like this. And I wanted to sort of not make that my starting point, but really try and proceed from ambivalence, from sort of genuine ambivalence, and see where that would take me. And so I'll just read a little bit of the introduction where I think about this. And one of the reasons why Milton is particularly sort of rich terrain for this is that people have been so ambivalent about him over the years. I think he's probably the most disliked of all the great English poets. So there really is a debate to be had about him as a person, as a poet, as a figure. And so I quote this wonderful line from T.S. Eliot, who was probably the most ambivalent of all readers of Milton, who says about Milton in one of his famous essays, he says, "As a man, he is antipathetic, either from the moralist's point of view, or from the theologian's point of view, or from the psychologist's point of view, or from that of the political philosopher, or, this is my favourite, judging by the ordinary standards of likeableness in human beings, Milton is unsatisfactory." Now, we can say, pot and kettle and all those kind of things when it comes to Eliot, but I wanted to kind of start with this question of, does it matter whether we find Milton likeable and what does it mean? And I say this at the end of this section in the introduction. I say, I'm tempted to see the ways in which Milton has violently divided opinion as a reflection of the ways in which he himself was divided, and the ways that I've been tempted to divide him. He was prophet and scholar, monument and shaker of monuments, bundle of facts and spur to imagination. He can, in all of these respects, at times feel itchingly close and familiar. At other times, he seems utterly alien, impossible to understand on our terms. But this isn't the either-or logic of a writer being time-bound or timeless that Ben Jonson proposes in his poem on Shakespeare, but something more like a wild oscillation between ways of thinking, feeling, and being. And it's on this basis that I'd like to retain and adapt Alexander Nehemas's, another Princeton figure, of course, Alexander Nehemas's claim that artworks are like friends, in that we trust them to change us in ways that we cannot anticipate. This is not the same as saying that we must always like artworks or their creators, just as indeed we do not always have to like our friends. We can be baffled, frustrated, exasperated by them. Our moods change in relation to them. We can want to be with them more at certain times than at others. In Shakespeare's Hamlet, when the ghost of the prince's father appears to him, his best friend Horatio quite understandably calls it wondrous strange. And Hamlet replies, "And therefore, as a stranger, give it welcome." This is my challenge throughout this book, not to tell the story of Milton's life as if I know in advance exactly what a life is, but to welcome Milton in the manner Hamlet urges, not by making him too familiar, but by allowing him to remain strange. In perhaps the most famous sentences from his prose writings, Milton proclaimed, "I cannot praise a fugitive and cloistered virtue, unexercised and unbreathed. That which purifies us is trial, and trial is by what is contrary." The challenge Milton set to his contemporaries with these words, which is to change themselves by encountering and navigating the difficult and the strange, to be exercised by what can often seem contrary, is throughout this book the challenge of how properly to welcome the strangeness of his life and his writings.
Milton goes to lengths in Paradise Lost, Joe, to get himself out of the way. There are moments in that poem where he brings his own eye forward, but insofar as he declares that it's inspired speech, it's not to be authored by him, it's not to come from him. And you've written a book that's full of him and full of you, and that is a participant in what we might think of as a critical movement now, sort of auto theory or auto criticism. And so I wonder if you'd start off by talking a little bit about that part of the book, how you got involved in this story, whether it is in spite of Milton, who he is and how he writes, or because of Milton and who he is and how he writes.
Yeah, thank you, Jeff. It's a great question. And so I suppose one way, what you say about him working very hard to get out of the way is so interesting, because it captures just what an equivocal stance that is, right? Because the working very hard draws attention to itself. So even the working very hard, even yelling from the rooftops, "I'm a mere conduit, I'm a vessel, I'm a, for divine utterance," has that curious combination of the self-erasing and the self-aggrandizing that's such a part of what it means to be a sort of prophetic or vatic figure. So I was always interested in that, because what it means, I suppose, is that you can see from that why, in some ways, Milton is the perfect subject of biography, and why he has been so much written about by biographers. He seems to, he's so often paired with Shakespeare. I do it myself in the book, but it seems to be the opposite problem. Shakespeare is nowhere. He's always dissolving into everything he touches. And Milton's the opposite. He is always himself. Every figure in every one of his works feels like it's voicing some aspect or sort of quality of him. And so you can see why that feels like a gift to a biographer. But at the same time, because of that sort of very curious dual impulse to put oneself forward and to erase oneself, that means biography is only ever going to tell part of the story. It's only going to have access to the parts that are telling us this is who I am and what I think. Sort of as if we can never say this is who I am and what I think and be right, right? If you don't believe that, if you feel like those self-confident, sure utterances are only ever going to be one part of a person, what do you do with that as a biographer? So that, I suppose, is the backdrop. The foreground is much more, I'll just say something much more contingent and ordinary about the sort of genesis of the book. I probably wouldn't, or I might not have put myself into it in the same way had I not had the chance to make a radio documentary about Milton. I write about this a bit in the book, but I got that, and I got the chance to go, partly because I had done some work for BBC Radio, and one thing I learned doing that is that if there's one thing the BBC loves, it's an anniversary. And there was an anniversary, the 350th anniversary of the publication of Paradise Lost was coming, and I thought, I could spin that. And I managed to convince them that it was very important that I go to Italy. and explore the places that Milton had been. My wife thought this was outrageous. She thought she said to me, I will stand in our living room and make the noises of Italy in the background. And why do you have to go to Italy to be on the radio? This is ludicrous. But there was a serious question there, which I found myself asking as I went to these places and then asking the book, which is, what am I doing? What does on the one hand there's something very alluring about that sort of here I am at this place, or possibly this place, maybe this place. And at the same time, a real genuine sense of the sort of oddness of that, okay, I'm here now, now what? And so what I think I discovered in the planning of the book was ways of connecting those two questions, the sort of bigger questions about Milton as a subject in both senses, him as a subject and a subject for biography. And then these questions about, and in a way, the only way for me to get at those was to think about, was to come up with via my own experiences and via those moments of genuine puzzle.
I got lost question. Joe, tell us more about the beginning of the book, because you begin with three takes on a certain figure, right? The chair, and the deep descriptions, followed by a brief biographical summary. When I read them, I thought I loved the whole thing. Then I realized I didn't fully recognize the difference between the scholar and the prophet.
Mm-hmm.
And I assume this is intentional. Right. I kind of sense that they're sitting in the same chair. One's got a sword, I think, and one's got they've got different colored eyes. But on the other hand, they're probably the same person. So we get that. Tell us a little bit about why you started that way and how that works.
Sure, thanks, Michael. Yeah, so I start the book. The introduction is called The Two John Miltons, and I begin with as Michael said, this sort of double take, or in a sense, about a triple take, of trying to sort of picture Milton. It was partly an attempt to do something that felt almost heretical in its own right, which is to ask the question, what would it have been like to write Paradise Lost? It's not the kind of question we're trained to ask when we're becoming literary critics. But one of the things I think I do say somewhere in the book that I really believe in is I think that actually one of the really basic but deep questions that artworks always pose to us is what would it have been like to make this thing? I think that's really underestimated as a challenge of an artwork. So I wanted to do that, and then that asking that question became a way into this idea. Well, what if I use this to play around with this sense of Milton as kind of, on the one hand, sort of attractively unitary and univocal, all these things, but on the other hand, having been many things to many people. So I play around with this idea of him. So one version is him actually receiving divine inspiration, actually kind of having this sense of a voice coming from elsewhere and dictating the poem to him, sort of putting the poem into his mind, almost like a kind of foreign substance. And the other one is him drawing upon the resources of his own reading and knowledge. But you're right, I then did, in a way, want to make them less obviously different from one another.
Also, the difference in inspiration is exactly the same lines. It's like a story by Voyage.
Yes, right, exactly. Totally different.
The script is the same.
Exactly. And part of what I wanted to do there is the sense that I didn't want to make the version of him when he's drawing upon his knowledge really boring, because I think that's you can sometimes feel when you're reading accounts of someone like him with an incredibly capacious mind and an amazing memory, as if memory, well fine, let's say Milton had those, but memory isn't like a filing system, it's not a neutral process of I need that fact, there it is. The experience of remembering, of drawing upon a lifetime of reading and thinking, might in its own way have been a kind of possession by other voices and other, it's just those are coming from books and other things you've read and not from God. Yeah. So it's a sort of completely different, but at the same time maybe not that different. And that's what I wanted to sort of play around with it in, that was to sort of unsettle our assumption about what scholarship looks like.
Yeah, and that's something you attribute to Milton as well, and a capacity to ask the question, what would it have been like? That he has a kind of phenomenological self-projection into some of the situations about which he writes. I wonder if you feel like Milton knew the difference between that kind of imaginative wager and inspiration and actually speaking words of God. Is he certain of the difference between projecting himself into an experience and being, as it were, possessed by? And what's the relationship between that Milton and you as you're trying to imagine him? Were you ever possessed by that?
Well, I think probably the honest answer to your question is that I'm not sure of that difference, and therefore I want Milton to be less sure of it. Right, so it feels in a certain way like yes, there is a sort of, I am suggesting kind of affinity there between, so one of the one of the reasons I wanted to play around with this approach is that, you know, again, sort of as I said, that conjuring of the scholar Milton is partly to try and bring to life the kind of non-neutrality of scholarship or a reading, you know, that these are also deeply sort of affected lived experiences, and therefore that that should also be true, that in some sense that should also be true of my experiences of him. You know, that again, that I wanted the actual experience of reading him, both in the moment and also across longer periods of time, to be really integral to the book. Because again, I think actually the ways that we read and remember what we read and associate things that we read with one another and with things in life is so much more complicated and strange and in a really sort of wonderful everyday way. But then when we think about things like Milton reading, why can't we imagine some of that similar sort of topography, you know, that sort of sense of it having a sort of, it being a sort of felt set of experiences too. So in that sense, I don't think I would ever claim a kind of experience of inspiration in my own right, but I'm interested in the affinity there. You know, there is underlying a kind of wager, which is, what if we allowed our imaginings of these figures' experiences of reading and other things being a bit more like ours than we usually do? Not the same in their content or exactly in the structure, but allow that sense of variety and of lived variety a little bit more into our approaches to.
I imagine that as being something that you did, if not in Milton's chair, in your chair, reading that's that sort of what would this be like. But you also did a lot of traveling. You went to a lot of places that Milton went to sort of put yourself in spaces and had complicated reactions to those sort of acts of self-translation, often disappointment or estrangement. Confusion. And I wonder if you could talk about that component of the biography, which feels a good deal different from travel writing or from biographical due diligence. There's a passage in particular we talked a little bit about in Horton.
In Love. I'll read one other passage in a second. Yes, absolutely. I suppose what I ended up feeling, I'll read this passage in a moment, but there's something very kind of interestingly eccentric about following, say, the patterns of where someone happens to have lived or where they happen to have travelled. It just becomes a really interesting way of going to places you wouldn't otherwise go. So I became less interested in it as a kind of search for an authentic kernel of something, and more as a kind of experiment, kind of let's see what happens. But also often what you're experiencing, but it is again a way of experiencing things that you already sort of knew but didn't really. So for example, I found it really interesting to go to certain places in London. You know, the site of the house where Milton was born, where I spent quite a lot of time in the book, is emphatically blank. It's part of this kind of bizarre, corporatized architecture of the city of London. You feel that sense of history having been wiped away by multiple waves of destruction in a way that is itself really interesting. You're not getting Milton on Press Street, but there is something about historical change that you experience only through those kind of slightly curious disjunctions. I'll read one moment from the book which talks about a particular experience that happened in one of these places, which is again doesn't really have anything to do with the bit of Milton that took me there, but ended up feeling like it really did. And that's again part of the kind of wager of the book, is that kind of thing might be worth doing in its own way. So this is when I went to Ludlow, where Milton's mask, which is not actually called Comus, but people tend to call Comus, was staged in the 1630s. Milton almost certainly never went to Ludlow. So it's a place that was entirely imagined by him, but he knew that this was going to be performed in this specific place. And I talk a bit about the book and so on, and then I say, the memory that sticks in my mind from this mini pilgrimage was not a fragment of the 17th century past that allowed me to feel connected with the true origins of Comus. It was rather another strange piece of happenstance. when we, I was there with a friend of mine, Sean, my former teacher, when we ascended the tallest tower in the castle, this is the ruins above the castle, we found the top crowded with a group of school children on a trip, all in uniform, who seemed to be waiting for something to happen. And it became clear that they were gathered around one of their number, a boy who couldn't have been more than 10 or 11 years old. He took a cello from a case that he had somehow schlepped to the top of the tower, sat on a chair and began to play a piece of Bach from memory with remarkable skill. We all stood rapt by what the spirit in Comus calls the soft and solemn breathing sound that rose like a steam of rich distilled perfumes and stole upon the air. I couldn't believe my luck. Less than 100 yards from where Milton's Masque was first performed, here was a scene that seemed its modern equivalent. Students and teachers, children performing before adults, and beautiful music rippling through the Ludlow afternoon. But then the boy finished, we all applauded, and it suddenly became more prosaic and distasteful. One of the teachers had been filming the performance on her telephone, and I heard her colleague mutter in her ear that he would arrange for it to be put on the school's website. They led the crowd of children back down the stairs. The boy who had played the cello was momentarily forgotten, left behind to struggle with the bulky instrument, and Sean and I helped him to return it to its case and begin to navigate the spiral of stone stairs back towards the ground. This boy is one of those individuals whose place in my memory is disproportionate to the brevity with which his path crossed mine, perhaps like Edward King, the subject of Lycidas, was for Milton. The more I thought about him, the more I realised that, though it felt at first like disappointment or disenchantment as the spell of the music was broken, in fact it was the whole strange scene that really did resonate for me with Comus. Milton's Masque is for me both spellbindingly beautiful and profoundly uncomfortable, a document not just of Milton's own hopes and fears and of the bizarre fascinations of a culture with a young woman's virginity and sexuality, this is the plot of the Masque, but of the ways in which children are asked in their upbringing and their education to perform versions of themselves for the benefit of adults, to reassure us with their normality and impress us with their virtuosity. And Comus is all of these things in a fascinating, troubling, inextricable combination, just as I can remember both the sound of Bach wafting from the top of a ruined castle and the sight of a small boy, having done what was required of him, staggering forgotten down its winding steps.
That's fantastic. I love that passage too. Here's a broader version of this question. One of the great attractions of this book is the number of times we don't know which genre we're in. And let me just name a couple of genres. What would be documentary? And what would be, what can we do with documentary material? The real place, the actual place, the press treatment. The other would be something like the historical imagination. Let's imagine it. And another one would be pure fiction. Now, all of those things are in this book. And you must have thought about them quite a lot. But they do merge, they are clearly separate. I mean, the pure fiction, the Kenelm, the Digby story, for example, mm-hmm. other stories where things. The situation of the writer say, I know this didn't happen, but I'm going to pretend it did. And I know there's no data here, but this might have been happening. And these are the data that I'm interpreting. A very different thing, actually, very different. But they're all very well done, but they're all quite different. They're different. What you just said, and that passage you just read, is an interesting reading of what comes across an accidental event mm-hmm. in your own life, which could have happened. Will not happen, but you see. What I like very much with the different gradings of this and the freedom of the and a certain ambivalence that arises in the reader about what it is we're reading.
Yes.
Who are we reading?
Yeah. And my hope is that, or my hope was in writing it to give readers enough, if they wanted to ask the question, to work out which of those genres they were in at any given moment, or perhaps to, I tried to be quite open about points at which I was at, as you say, in the realm of the might have happened,
yes.
as opposed to the probably did happen, or it certainly did happen. So I hope the experience is somewhat of sliding between those things, But what I wanted to do was give people the experience of that sliding, interspersed with moments where you're sort of brought back from that slightly and said, okay, where have we just been? What have we just been doing? And again, I'm sort of interested in these techniques in broad ways, but I do think, I mean, I did feel underneath all that as well that there was, I feel like I'm getting feedback slightly, I don't know if that's,
yeah,
maybe I'm just too close to your mic.
I think
maybe that our mics are a bit close to each other or something, I don't know. Is that better? I think that is, I think maybe we're just a bit close. I mean, I don't say this in the book, but certainly part of what was in the back of my mind there also is again that Milton himself is so interested in genre and sort of almost lives his life through this series of genres. And he has this incredible approach, it seems to me, to literary genres where he's going to adopt one, bring it to perfection and end it and move on. So he has this kind of amazing relationship with I think the way you put it, Michael, was to say, we don't know what genre we're in. I do think Milton, to some extent, thought of his life in those terms. What genre am I in? So again, I hope underneath it is a sense that I'm not suggesting that what I'm doing in that moment is in any sense Miltonic, but I hope it means that playing with genre is at least recognisable to the reader as an engagement with something that Milton himself was doing. And therefore not just an arbitrary thing that I'm doing because I think it's fun, although I did think it was fun. but fun that has its feet in some kind of its sort of roots in some kind of tangible reality and then is allowed to kind of grow in more eccentric direction.
Yeah, I love that, Jeff. Also, it puts it in two things. One is in that reading,
the life itself is a matter of which genre we're in at any given moment. There are no genreless moments. you don't just live life and wait for it to be a play, don't you? It's always a play. I like it. And the other thing, you have to use a wonderful word, is somewhere, as a version of some, as the equivalent in time of somewhere. And I think that that's a key, for me, was a key to a lot of this stuff. The idea of whatever, but it's going to happen somewhere.
Yeah. No, that's lovely. Yes, the question, when are we?
Yes, it's great.
Which is, but it feels like it is often one that's worth asking when reading. But also again, I think it's the bit I read from the introduction, I think we were talking about this very briefly before as well, reading is so much a matter, well, especially rereading, which again, we don't talk about as much as we probably should. There's a kind of pretense. One other thing I wanted to do in this was write about the sort of processes of reading, the actual process of coming to terms with a piece of writing. And again, part of what that means is it kind of it sort of lodges itself in your mind and in your life and connects to all the other things you're interested in curious ways that you're often not fully aware of. And what that means is rereading becomes really interesting because you're seeing new things in the work, but you're also sort of bumping into former versions of yourself. And so reading becomes temporally complicated. You have the sort of, and I found myself thinking as I worked on this, as I kind of tried to work out why Milton meant so much to me, had come to over the years, it's partly, I feel like he does that in such complicated and interesting ways. He turns his poems into these kind of temporally extremely complicated artifacts that become sort of invitations to bring to them one's own tangled, complicated, multi-layered forms of time, all the people we have been and all the things we might experience. And so it's that sort of, that sort of loops back to Jeff's question too. I think that was the basis on which I was trying to bring myself and Milton together, is not based on some sort of, necessarily some profound affinity, but just this feeling that that's always what reading is to some extent, is these weird somewhens kind of coming together. And it's just that he thematizes that, he makes that part of the work in a really complicated way.
I just love that we're always asking, where am I? But when do we ask, when am I?
where am I in time?
Yeah, it feels like the book has a couple of different ways of asking that question. One of them is genre, because genres have different times and time scales associated with them. But another is your interest in rhythm. When am I, and in what rhythm am I participating, in what place, or what genre, or what music, or what poetry? Maybe you could say a little bit about how important the idea of rhythm is to this book.
Yeah, so rhythm became, I mean, I think in a way the best way to explain it is that rhythm was the sort of meeting point or sort of gathering point for what I was saying to Michael. Like, that was where those things would come together. And it's partly actually to do with, I think it worked also because I was interested in the kind of difference. I suppose in the question of size or scale, that I wanted to think about the larger arcs of Milton's own life and of ours. You know, I'm thinking at times in terms of centuries. You know, again, it's what I love about Milton. At times we're thinking about centuries. At times we're thinking about sort of timeless, you know, sort of eons of distance. And at times we're thinking about the intense sort of vicissitudes of this moment that you're in. And what I liked about rhythm as a term, and what you know, people have written about this fascinating ways, is that it can encompass all of those things, you know, that a life has a rhythm, a city has a rhythm, any given organism, it's a way of thinking about, as in that wonderful account that Dorothea quoted in her introduction, it's a way of thinking about this sort of, I suppose, interplay or kind of balance between change and continuity on many scales. It's also not a word that Milton uses anywhere. Well, actually, I'm not quite very open about that, but there's that wonderful thing I quote, I think, briefly from Mallarmé, which is the soul is a knot of
goodness.
And again, Mallarmé loved Milton, so there's no reason to quote him. But I mostly just wanted to quote him because it's a wonderful line. But yeah, I think it was really that gathering together of scales that it gave me.
I'm tempted to go in so many directions, but you're having mentioned Mallarmé, there are so many different voices in this, each with their own rhythms. And Milton himself is makes a conspicuous display of the extent of his own learning, all of the different voices that come in his poetry and in his prose. How did you think about your own freedom to refer to your own reading in relation to the performance of learning and his own reading?
That's a great question. That's a great question, thanks, Jeff. What I tried to do, and again, this will be a sort of appropriately Princeton-focused answer. I quoted Alexander Mehamas briefly in the introduction, who did teach me a bit when I was a graduate student, and his work I deeply admire. And I was really struck by I remember a particular thing he said, which he then did write about subsequently, about thinking about the canon of great literature. He said we shouldn't think about the canon in an impersonal way. We should think about our own canons. We all have canons. And those are things that connect in and through us. I remember him kind of listing his favorites. It was just really, it was all things you'd expect, you know, Nietzsche and Proust and Plato, and you know, his kind of greatest hits. But then he mentioned, I think it was Frasier and Oz. I've never had the chance to ask him, what do you love about those TV shows so much? But I'd love to know, you know, and that's part of the intriguing thing about someone's canon, is then you start asking yourself really weird and interesting questions like, what if Nietzsche and Frasier has to do with one another? or, you know, Montaigne and Oz. I mean, what's that got to? What's that going to tell me? And so, when you start thinking about, as he does in his work, about sort of about literature in life, as well as life as literature, then it's partly about just kind of creating these connections that are lived connections. In some sense, those things belong together through Alexander Mehamas's engagement with them and writing about them. And so, I felt in a way like that was the freedom that I was giving myself, was to do that. And I would say, sort of interestingly, those are the kind of things in my experience that we do a lot more when we teach than when we write a lot of the time. Teaching is often about saying, oh, this reminds me of this thing. Because what you're then doing is sort of allowing things to become interesting in relation to one another. And so that, I think that's what I felt like I was doing.
It's such a sympathetic account, and it was very helpful to me to encounter it in the texture of this book, partly because I think I endow Milton with a very different kind of learning. That is, I think I have just always assumed deferentially that Milton selects from a plenum of literary knowledge. He knows it all, and at a given moment, he chooses what, you know, what he wants to use, as opposed to finding his way in a kind of tangled path of textual encounters, some of which are more recent, some of which are more distant, which are connected to each other in continuing ways. What's your feeling for the relationship between Milton's reading? Is Milton as well described by Naamas as you yourself are?
I mean, I guess one obvious way to go with that question, especially with you asking it, is to say that Milton's most famous piece of literary citation is his misremembering of the fairy queen, right? His most famous citation from English poetry is when he completely garbles the plot of Book Two of the Fairy Queen and says something happened that just didn't happen. And obviously that's been much discussed and debated, but it does feel kind of, there is something great about that, that his most conspicuous citation of this great poet and predecessor is an error and is something that seems more to be kind of dredged up from half-remembered knowledge, or perhaps it's something that he just hasn't read that recently and never thought to check. I'm sort of willing to take that seriously as a possibility, that there is variety here. You know, there is, you know, it might be a difference. Yeah, yes, I mean, obviously, that, you know, there are things that he clearly did know to an extraordinary degree of extraordinary level of detail. But I think that moment, as much as the kind of transformed citations from his predecessors in Paradise Lost do seem to rely on much more detail, those are in very different ways raising this same and connected set of questions about what does it mean to know literature, right? And I do think, I do take that sort of Spencer error as my guiding light, to allow myself to imagine a version of him which does not have the perfect plenum of knowledge that you're describing.
Don't know if that should be a...
Yeah, if you have another
one
more question that you
want to
ask, then...
I would love to hear a bit of poetry. I mean, talk about a poem, talk about the old utility ode, for example. Just how Milton gets it. Milton, the actual poet, gets a
sure.
Gets say.
Well, I'll
read a bit of the
sure. Well, maybe I'll, I might, if it's okay, well, if I can find it in here, actually, I might just read the opening of. The two poems that I spend the longest, the two poems that I spend the longest sustained time with in the book are The Nativity Ode and Lycidas. And I'm actually just wondering if I should just read the opening five lines of Lycidas. Yeah. I spent quite a lot of time going on about them in the opening of that chapter. I'll just read these and then we can throw it open after that. This is how Lycidas begins. And I'm partly interested in these are just amazing lines to hear. Yet once more, O ye laurels, and once more, ye myrtles brown, with ivy never sear, I come to pluck your berries harsh and crude, and with forced fingers rude, shatter your leaves before the mellowing year.
The reason I ask that question is that my first memory of creative writing was taking the sonnet, which begins Sergeant or something on Mount Arms, whatever it is, and rewriting it as it was addressed to the postman. That was my beginning of literature.
Maybe I'll take one of the mics. Can you share it?
The
sorry, you can't, we can't ask you to recite your rewrite. So we have some time for questions, if there are any in the room or online. There's one question online we can go to, but by all means, just type more in if there are more questions, or raise your hand.
Yes, thank you. Wonderful book. Love the introduction. There's a part later on where one of your students points out a clock face as a particular part of imagery you've never considered. And this all leads to, after all of this, after all this traveling, are you done being surprised by Milton? Or, you know, is this done? You've written the book, you've gone on tour, you know, can we...
Thanks for that. No, certainly not. I mean, I think the but I think it's a really great question, because I again think that the capacity to be surprised, and then in a slightly more kind of self-reflexive and hopefully not too navel-gazing sort of way, the capacity then to surprise ourselves, right? Feels to me like, again, a really important part of our responses to the things we read and to art of all kinds is to be surprised by something and then to be surprised that one can still be surprised, right? It feels to me like really, really important things to hold on to. And they can also happen through, again, it's about misremembering things. I was thinking about, you know, going back to Milton's era with Spencer, we get surprised because we're imperfect and we forget things and we get things wrong. And there's a wonderful moment in, I was thinking about this because of being here with Michael, with whom I read some of Stanley Cavell's work many years ago. There's a wonderful moment in Stanley Cavell's book on film, where he has an afterword to his book on film. He says, it was pointed out to me after this book came out that I completely got wrong the ending of the rules of the game. I just totally misremembered it. Isn't it interesting that I got it so wrong? What does that tell us about the rules of the game? Now, we can't all do that, and we probably shouldn't. But there is something wonderful about that sense that that form of surprise is always possible. And maybe the fact that we need to forget things is a kind of hope. It's a sort of hopeful thing, because it means it's never finished.
This makes me think of a question to ask that I'll slip in I guess I wanted to ask you about pedagogy, and you know, you mentioned that you're thinking out loud quite a bit about reading in the book, and now you're saying, well, you know, you're quoting or referencing that passage in Cavell. There's a sense in which I feel like I'm being given a sort of pedagogy in your book that is one of difficulty for sure, uncertainty in some ways, but also this kind of dwelling in your own response, right? Dwelling in and taking very seriously your own response, and almost being authorized to do a kind of piracy with that, you know, take what you need and stay with it. So I wonder whether you've taught Milton. Jeff, I know you teach Milton. I don't know, Michael, if you've taught Milton, but are you teaching Milton differently as a result of writing this book? Do you, this sort of ambit of questions about pedagogy coming out of that book?
Thanks, Dorothea. That's a wonderful question. And yes, I mean, I am teaching Milton differently, and I have brought more of this kind of questioning and the sorts of discussions we're having today. I have been bringing it more into my teaching. I think that, it's a great question. What do I want to say about that? I mean, I think, again, it goes back to my interest in the book in sort of time and process, that I think the process of reading and the process of learning, I feel, have more place in the way we talk and think and write about literature. That's actually where we tend to, that's where the interesting stuff tends to happen, and yet it's the outcome that there's this assumption that all that should be written down is the finished bit, is the kind of outcome, and so I would say Yeah, I'm very keen on that idea of kind of, you know, of encouraging students to sort of dwell in their responses. But part of that, right, is also the sense that, that the response isn't the end of the story, right? It's not about saying, oh, I've had this response, and therefore, it goes back really again to the question about being able to surprise ourselves, that saying I had this response to this piece of literature, I read this Milton poem, and I had this response, that's not the answer, that's the posing of the problem. You know, that's the interesting question, is why has this come about? And the disentangling of that is going to mean a combination, I think, of self-reflection and learning more about the poem, about the world from which the poem emerged. It's so much more curious and complicated, a sort of bundle of processes, and all of them need to be happening in conjunction, which can sound kind of exhausting, but it's actually very exciting. I think they're much more sort of true to how we actually read and teach. But you know, as I said to Jeff, and obviously again, I do sort of apologize, it's becoming a bit of a loving, but it is very exciting to be being back in Princeton where I was taught. I mean, it does feel very and wonderful to be doing this event with Jeff and Michael and with Leonard in the audience and so on. It's sad not to have Nigel Smith here, who's the missing person here of all this. He's not at Stanford. But you know, I was thinking about that a lot as I read and feeling like for me that had been so much about sort of things that took place through time, things that took time. I should also say, by the way, that there's a whole section of the book that's about Milton's education, which is also about violence and being sort of terrorized at school. So it's by no means all a happy story about what a wonderful thing teaching is. It involves a lot of violence. It could have can involve a lot of violence and coercion as well, but I wanted to think about those sets of processes together.
This is a very practical question where I sit and ask it, what can you teach me? Where do you stop? I mean, I'm speaking to someone who is just now, even after you, has just come out with a very self-oriented book on that sort of second-rate other English writer, Shakespeare. If only Nigel were here, he would. Where do you stop? I mean, I think that I didn't know where to stop, and that readers of my book will say, well, he didn't know where to stop. So I wonder, by which I mean, sort of, where do you stop the sort of the larger, the associative processes, yourself, you know, your location, you know, where you happen to be, where, you know, Milton, I won't sort of use the laboratory. Where do you stop? And on what basis do you say, or maybe you don't, but on what basis do you say there's a decorum, not about nasty or dirty things, but just about the picture of a literary life? What's too much of Moshenska?
It's a great question, and I think, I don't think. Because, as you say, once you start to go down these roads, as you know it too well, there is no natural impact. It's partly, I think, this is where also it goes back to. I mean, it feels to me like it's as much a question of form, the form of the writing. Right? I think that's where you have to find out what you can do. In a sense, you know, I mean, I'd be interested to know, you know, more about how you found this in the Shakespeare, which I can't wait to read, of course. But a lot of this is experimenting, I think, and finding out from your own, you know, from your own reading and from others' responses to it, what does and doesn't work. Because in some sense, I think that can only happen as a process of formal experimentation. And I suppose the other thing is, and it doesn't work for you know, I've been generally very chuffed with the reviews of the book, but I think when Michael asked the question about genres and me, I do fiction, I have these, we didn't really go into this now, but I have these kind of fictionalized scenes within the book, some of which are much more firmly grounded in verifiable fact than others. And this did induce a hilariously harumphing column in the Daily Telegraph from a very disreputable Tory historian saying, with a headline something like, "Should biographers make things up?" So you don't, you know, some people do feel like they get those things wrong, and you know, I had another reviewer saying, did we really need to know about me breaking my finger while I was playing football? Well, you know, I said, probably not, but so for me it's about doing enough pushing at those boundaries to raise the question of where you stop, or of what belongs and what doesn't. I feel like in some ways there is something about those more extraneous moments. There is, I think, a kind of, you are implicitly asking your reader, you feel more conscious of asking your reader, will you go here with me? Will you trust me enough to go? And then you pull back, or I pull back, that's what I felt like I was doing. And you know in some sense that not every reader is going to enjoy each of those moments. But I think actually that experience of pushing beyond and then contracting back is where I hope the book becomes partly about that question. I think it's, you know, about that question of what's relevant, what isn't. You know, once you've accepted that anything could come in, those are the moments where it's like it hopefully gets kind of folded into the questions that the book is asking. But yeah, it's a haunting question when you're actually writing it. Where to draw the line?
There is a question online from Barbara Walter inviting you to think about Dante as one of the voices that Milton heard. It's a large question.
Oh,
see if you want a slice of that.
No, that's a great question. And I mean, I certainly think Dante is an important source for the what might it have felt like question. That, as Jeff said, I pose and see Milton as posing. I would think that was one of the places he felt that, the kind of extraordinary sort of phenomenological vividness of Dante, especially at those moments in the Inferno. I was just reading recently the account of the soothsayers and the prophets with their heads twisted backwards and the tears running down the clefts of their buttocks. I mean, it's just this extraordinarily vivid, not enough just a gesture of suffering or but to really inhabit the intimate physical specificity of that. And then, of course, although I think he does a very different version of it, but the sort of playing with the relationship between the authorial persona and the historical individual, you know, that sense of being totally in the writing to the extent that it's constantly tempting to just say it's Dante, to just call the speaker of the Commedia Dante. So I think he's a really rich resource for Milton. But then of course Milton's Satan is so utterly unlike the version of Satan we encounter at the end of the video. But I think we are supposed to somehow sort of measure that distance too. So he's very keen as ever to learn huge amounts from these crucial predecessors, and then also to distance himself as widely from them in other respects as he can. But thank you, it's a great question.
Are there other questions in the room?
Yeah, one more. I'm just curious, we're drawn to different texts, different authors, and that kind of thing. One Milton's text, what drew you in specifically about how he uses language to express himself? And why did that draw you in and encourage you to spend so many years writing about him and experiencing and writing his biography?
Thank you. It's a great question, and I won't just dodge the question. But what I will say is that I really wrote the book to find that out. You know, there is something interesting, I think, especially when you work on very canonical figures. No one ever asked me that question, right? years and years I worked on these guys, and neither I nor anyone else really felt the need to say why. I mean, you might, you know, people have never heard of them or don't find them interesting or whatever, but there isn't the feeling that it really needs justifying in a way, you know, because they are sort of culturally important. And so I really did write the book to ask that question. I think the thing I said in the introduction, in the bit I read from the introduction, it goes back to the question, one of the ways I was thinking about rhythm, is probably what I come back to. I think from what I discovered in writing this is that for me, what Milton captures in a particular vividness or pushes to a particular extreme is something that I find fascinating in all of the literature from the early modern period that I love. It's something about this, so that in some sense might be the most important rhythm. It's that rhythm of kind of sort of oscillation between vivid sameness. I know this guy. I understand this. I understand this world. I'm there. I get it. You know, historical difference, historical difference. It's all available. And on the other hand, and then suddenly the pendulum swings and you're, what is going, you know, what is this totally other human that I will never even scratch the surface of and begin to understand? Of course, there's a lot of debate about which of those is true, or which is perhaps a sort of better or more firm or more a sort of interesting basis for thinking about why we read. What I came to think as I wrote this book is that actually, for me, it's it's the sort of oscillation between the actual truth of those alternatives that reading him gives me, and I think all reading gives me that. All the meaning that I value gives me that alternation, which is interesting and useful for thinking about the world we're in and the people we encounter and so on. But I think these literary figures give us that. And for me, Milton is the most, when he's alien, he's the most alien. And when he's vivid and close and intimate in particular, he's the most of all those things. And it's the ability to combine those extremes within the same space, within the same texts, that I think electrifies him.
That's very beautiful, and I think in reading the book, there are so many dimensions in which you give answers to that question of why Milton for you, and yet at the same time, you leave the reader, or me at least, with a feeling that perhaps the answer to that also will still escape you and is not finished, and in that way, you are true to the premises of the book, right? So that's also a question that is unfinished, it feels like. So it's a wonderful book. You should pick up a copy. And I'll just say before we thank these three that if you want to buy a copy, I'll run upstairs and you can just pay on your way out. So, but that's the prosaic part. Much more importantly, thank you, Michael. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Joe. It's been wonderful.